Hey everyone, welcome to Theater of Revolt. I hope you all had a great Memorial Weekend celebration last weekend. Missed you terribly, but I got some relaxation time in myself, so I hope you did as well. But we're back here at Theater of Revolt. We have a wonderful program today. We're going to look at a very unique play called Electricidad, which is a, I say it's unique because it's based on a Greek classic, but if you were to watch the actual production of it, you would never have guessed that it came from a play by Sophocles in the 5th century BC. Anyway, we'll look forward to talking to you about Electricidad. I just want to inform you about what we're doing here with the Applied Studies program. This class is part of the Applied Studies Bachelor's Degree Completion Program. Classes are broadcast live on this cable television channel and webcast on the internet each week. And this summer we have four classes: Interdisciplinary Studies 336, that's Perspectives and Civilization, that's Tuesday nights, 7 to 9 p.m. Psychology 372 is Industrial and Organizational Psychology, and that's Saturdays from noon to 1:40. Social Behavioral Sciences 318, that's Cultural Pluralism, focusing on immigration. And that's Saturdays, 1:50 to 3:30 p.m. And our own Humanities 310, Theater of Revolt, is noon on Sundays to 2 p.m. If you've completed the first 2 years of college, you could earn your bachelor's degree by enrolling in these classes. All the courses that you need to complete your bachelor's degree will be broadcast on this channel during the next 2 years, and then the process starts all over again. So if you like more information, you can see there on your screen, there's a website, www.appliedstudies.tv, or you may want to call us at 1-866-278-6789. Wonderful program, very, very focused students. I'm going to read you some of their analysis of the play that we've talked about. And if you're following the broadcast and you're not part of the show, part of the class, that's okay. This is a unique play. We'll try to present clips from it from a production that we've done in the past. We'll read some sections of it, so hopefully you'll be informed as to what Luis Alfaro's very unique adaptation, Electricidad, is all about. And that'll help you to understand our students' comments. But we are live here, so we'd love to hear from you. And hoping that Crystal is going to comment, too, on some of our insights here. We have one student who's waiting by anxiously to interact with us. But theater is an interactive medium, and that's why we put this number on the screen. Hopefully you'll give us a call, 1-800-339-1193. I'll give you some focus questions for today, but at the same time, if you have any questions about the program, anything we discuss on the program, or theater, writing plays, feel free to join us. Now, most of our students are going to be logging onto the internet, so you may want to do that as well. You can post a question or make a response to something that we've mentioned here by just going onto dhtv.csudh.edu. And I will be able to read your comments from the screens here and make it something of a discussion. It's not as active, perhaps, as in-class face-to-face discussion, but it's a unique way to do a broadcast by trying to engender some form of discussion into it. So feel free to join us today. Look forward to your comments. Okay, so today we're going to talk about Luis Alfaro, very unique playwright. We're going to talk about the two worlds of this play, which is may seem so disparate: ancient Greece and contemporary life in East LA, which is where he wrote the play to take place. So we'll look at the contrast of these two worlds, the contrast in their artistic styles. This is a humanities upper division integrative studies class, which means that it's not just, as in our case, to look at plays, although we do, but we look at how the rest of the areas of the humanities connect with that play. So we may talk about philosophy today. We may talk about the arts. We'll talk certainly a little bit about history and how that impacts it. So it's meant to be a class on making connections. And obviously this is in the humanities area, although sometimes we'll make some scientific connections too. So we'll talk a little bit about that, the world of the play, and we'll integrate some of the comments from our class. You know, I've had such great comments. I want to just introduce you to some of the ways that our students are looking at this play. What I ask them to do every week with the play that they read, because we read one play a week for like 13 weeks, so they're doing a lot of play analysis out there, which is something that many of us never do. So It's a new territory for many, but it's also an interesting aspect to do. It's not watching films, you're not watching television, you're actually reading plays. So it's a new skill for many. But I just want you to listen to some of the comments, for instance, that are made. I asked them on the discussion board to post one question about the play. If they were to try to get other students to discuss, what would be a focus question that they would offer? And also then I asked them to respond to some comments, one of those questions. So, for instance, here's a great example by Christy Aldridge, who gave us a focus question, and I'll just read this to you. Do you think it would have been necessary or helpful if author Luis Alfaro went deeper into the relationship between Clemencia, the mother, and Electricidad, her daughter, to better illustrate why there was so much background hatred for the mother? Or did the author give his audience enough with the knowledge of the killing of her father? Why or why not? I read this because even if you haven't read the play, what Christy is doing is asking us, I think, to almost consider whether this is a realistic play or whether it's meant to have more impact on you, perhaps in a stylistic way. If it were a realistic play, you're right, Christy, he should have gone deeper into the psychological reasons why Electricidad, the daughter of the play, is so antagonistic to the mother. I mean, she doesn't budge from her hatred of the mother, despite, I mean, the structure of the play is different characters coming in to try to talk her out of her anger against her mother, and it doesn't work, right? So, very good question. What explains her anger? And that's the kinds of questions that have some depth to them. And I'm applauding you, Christy. I'm also asking the class to consider questions like that, that really ask you to almost kind of think about the whole play, too. So it's a very in-depth question, very good focus question. I do want to say, though, just as a comment to it, Christy, this is not a realistic play. Obviously, if it's based on a Greek classic, which were very unrealistic, characters standing wearing masks, men playing women's roles, almost direct address to an audience, never any kind of interaction on stage. They were almost monologues that were told to an audience. It was almost a story-told form. And to some extent, even though Alfaro has definitely gone into a realistic world here with East L.A., he does not go into the in-depth psychology, and he's perhaps staying above it all in order to make something of a political statement. So it's an interesting question you made, Christy, and I applaud you on that. I wanted to also share with you a good example, let's say, of some of the responses that students are making. Now, here's a question that Leticia Galvan asked, which is also a very good question. She asked, Orestes was portrayed as a sensitive and loving individual. He had never been in a fight, yet he was able to kill his mother. Why do you think he was able to commit this horrible act? Great question. For those of you who know the play, it was not easy for him to do this, partially because of that sensitivity. But I also want to share with you this great comment that Kathy Cribbins gives to that question by Leticia. And I also bring this up because look at the depth that Kathy goes into in explaining herself. And that's what these discussion boards are about. And quite honestly, it's what what we go to college for, it's what instructors are asking you to do in college papers, is explain yourself. Go into some depth. Use examples. Give us details. Watch how Kathy does this. This is a common theme we see in other mythological works. The son is expected to rule when the father dies. This power is passed from male to male, generation to generation, and nothing is to interfere with this exchange. The son is expected to carry on the father's legacy of power and rule with unwavering dedication to the empire. And in parentheses, she has the barrio in this case. Nothing interferes with this tradition, especially not the inferior and dominated on whom rulers exert their power. Orestes was referred to as a sensitive and loving individual, true, but he was sent away with Nino, an older Cholo godfather, to toughen up physically and emotionally and to strengthen the qualities that would be vital to his assuming the place in the barrio. I believe Alfaro wanted us to see that Electricidad was the only one who could have best carry out El Augie's reign. I'm going to stop here, Kathy, but because she goes on the same amount to finish. I only read half of it. But notice the examples that she's using, that Orestes wasn't fit yet, had to go to be kind of trained into this position, and now she's making the point that it was really Electricidad who had this revenge motive. She was the one who carried it out. But also beautifully explained phrases, unwavering dedication to the empire. And most, what I enjoy most here, Kathy, is you are making a connection with the world of the play that Luis Alfaro drew from. This is not just the Greek tradition. The English, in the great age of kings, would call it primogeniture. The firstborn son is the one that rules. So we're looking at a patriarchal system here, and Kathy is looking at that question in depth. So that's what this class, in a way, is meant to be. It uses plays to give you a chance to do some critical thinking. So sorry to go on at such length, but Kathy, Leticia, thank you for giving us such a good example of what a good question is and what a good response is. And that's the heart of what an online class happens to be. You're basically kind of doing essays. That's what you're writing. So today, I'd like to give you some focus questions that might help you to respond. And these are from our students. We have a couple of interesting posts that were created. Peter Crossan sent one up, which is, what would you say is the dramatic function of the vicinas? Okay, now the vicinas, as you'll see in the play, is a kind of chorus in the Greek plays. You would have 12 people on stage dressed as like the elders of the town. Well, Alfaro has made an amazing change in this play by having three neighborhood ladies, these viejas, who come in sweeping with their brooms and talking chisme the whole time, talking about the situation. It's a wonderfully imaginative adaptation from the original. But what is the dramatic function, Peter asks? In other words, when we say dramatic function, we're asking, what do they do for the play? What are they actually contributing to the play itself in terms of how the play works? I wanted to bring up Peter's original question here, and I'm looking forward on the discussion board. But that is one focus question that we can definitely use. So thank you, Peter, for giving us that one. That's an ideal question for today. But here's another. Oh, sorry. Here's his question, and I just want to show you how Peter phrased this because it's also very nicely done. The author Luis Alfaro uses las vecinas, which are the three voices. They actually have names in the play: La Carmen, La Cuca, La Cani, as the voice of the city. This voice continually measures the current state, the events of the moment, against what is normal for the barrio. The author chooses to split up almost every sentence of these three characters' dialogue among all of them. What is the effect gained by using this approach? Would the voice of the barrio have a different effect if it was delivered by just a single character as a narration? That's a great, great question, Peter. And we're going to show a clip from the beginning of the show that shows you this very clipped dialogue. So that's a great focus question. You may want to respond to Peter's question. The other question is, a number of students have asked, what does the Spanglish do for this play? So we're asking another focus question, and this one came from Robert Nottingham. Basically, what is la importancia, we can use a little Spanglish in there, of both languages being used? Is there any advantage to that we have Spanglish being used in the play? Does it contribute? Does it add something valuable? Or is it something that maybe takes away? Let's see what Robert says. I'll phrase this in Robert's words. I like using some of the students' own comments, but this is what Robert wrote. Throughout the play, Spanish and English are interwoven into sentences. Is this Spanglish used to set some sort of Hispanic gangster theme, or does it symbolize something much deeper? So that's actually what Robert is asking, but we're going to shorten it and say, what do you think is the importance of using both languages in the play? What does that contribute? So really, Peter, Robert, thank you so much. That's going to be our focus questions for today. One more focus question, though, and this applies to the whole concept of the course. How do you see revolt in this play? How does this play fit into our whole concept of theater of revolt? All right, so there's our focus questions for today, and definitely feel free to comment on them. But at first, I think what I want to do is just introduce a little bit to you about the playwright Luis Alfaro. Luis is a wonderful, wonderful artist. He is a critically acclaimed writer. He's a performer. In fact, he came to Dominguez Hills when we were doing our production of Electricidad, and the students were spellbound. He's kind of like a performance artist, very, very funny, but also quite literary. His phrasings are something you want to like write down. He's a poet too. I should say that that's where he began, is writing poems about his hometown. He was born in the Pico Union district of downtown LA, and it is a point of fascination in a lot of his work. But he's written short stories. He's done poetry, plays. And in the process of his wonderful career, he's a character himself, but he's also been able to receive many awards. He's taken a MacArthur Foundation Fellowship. The National Endowment of the Arts gave him a residency grant at the Taper. He was awarded a Kennedy Center Fund for New American Plays twice for both Electricidad and another show that he wrote called Breakfast, Lunch, and Dinner. And at the Mark Taper Forum, he is the co-director of the Latino Theater Initiative, where he has, that's where they did Electricidad. It actually started in Tucson, but it came here, and I saw that production. It was quite wonderful. But he has, he's an activist. He works with at-risk youths. And in fact, he got the idea for writing Electricidad from interviewing a girl who was incarcerated for taking out a hit on her her mother, which has all to do with what the play is about. And he's co-founded non-profit for the arts organizations. He's a very active Chicano artist, and quite a hilarious entertainer at the same time. So Luis Alfaro, he comes from a background that knows what works in theater, very much a theater artist, both as a director, as an actor, and a playwright. So yeah, very interesting background. And his plays have done well all over. Bitter Homes and Gardens is one that we've done here, a very humorous look at the dysfunctional Chicano family, which is Electricidad as well. And he wrote a play actually called Los Vecinos, The Neighbors. So ties in a little bit to the concept of our play. But let's talk a little bit about Electricidad and this whole mythology of revolt, because there's a very interesting concept behind this play, which is that revolt is perhaps quite a natural thing. You know, it's funny. It seems that the stories that have been handed down through generations, the ones that survive, those that we call myths, which usually are about explaining how the universe works, why the sun comes up at one point and goes down at another point, even though that's not the actual scientific explanation. But it's interesting how many of these stories feature revolt as a natural theme. And a lot of these stories that are told in not just Greek civilization, but African, Hindu, have to do with going up against some oppressive force. So the nature of revolt, in a way, is there in many, many stories. The Golden Age of Greece, if we want to look a little bit at this famous time, we can see that there's a lot of mythological stories that came out of this tradition. I'm thinking of, for instance, the famous Greek myth of Demeter. Demeter was the mother of the earth, and her daughter disappeared. She looks all over and tries to get the other gods to help her. Well, they find out that Hades, the guy who lives down below, he abducted Persephone, right? And Demeter is furious and refuses to let anything grow on the earth. Finally, it's the mother of Zeus, Rhea, who makes a compromise and says Persephone can be reunited with her mother during the spring and summer months, and she can live above. But during the fall and winter, she has to go below and live with her husband, Hades. So this is the way that you would explain to a 7-year-old why it's warm in the summer and why it's cold in the winter and dark. You would tell the story of Persephone, what happened to Persephone. And that's the explanation, that's the mythological explanation, which obviously is not scientific at all. But to some extent, it may have some moral truth to it than our own scientific explanation. The Greeks were very satirical in many ways, and there was something of a comment made about marriage in this, something of a feminist comment, perhaps, that when Persephone has to suffer in the darkness, she's there with her husband, whereas when she's celebrating life in the spring and summer, she's back with her mother. So these are stories that are meant to tell us the truths of life. And the Greek civilization, especially when we look at the golden age of Greece, those years between the success in the battle against Persia all the way to the Peloponnesian War from 546 to 406 BC, that whole century and a half was a time of great high culture, very political stability. The origins of democracy come from Greece. This is the great age of Pericles, obviously of great architecture and poetry, philosophical accomplishments, so that we have only about a quarter of the great plays that were produced there at places like the City Dionysia. This was a week of celebration that actually was the spring fertility rite and born of ritual and developed into theater. So that for 3 days, a single playwright would present three tragedies followed by a comedy. It was a competition of sorts. And most all of the plays were about mythological stories that had been handed down. And it's interesting that the Electra story is one that was told by three of the greatest dramatists, Aeschylus, Sophocles, and Euripides. All three of them wanted to deal with the Electra story. So it makes sense that Luis Alfaro would want to do a version as well. But these were highly active times for Greek civilization. So dilemmas about what to do with the problem of revenge, issues like that were very central to what they were debating, not only in the assembly, but in plays that were done in this springtime event. The City Dionysia was usually April, May in that time there. But it actually began as hymns that were sung to the god Dionysius. And we'll take a look at Dionysius in a little bit. But the other world of this play, which is what Luis Alfaro has done in terms of making this connection, is so unique, is Mexican-American gangs. We're looking at life in East L.A., and the origin here has many, many factors. Many scholars have written that the attitudes and values that we find among Mexican-American gangs are the result of the systemic suppression of the Mexican-American people, which goes back to the conquest of California, 1848. Many of these scholars, like Mirende, will argue that racial discrimination, economic barriers, the difficulty for an immigrant family to assimilate into American culture left parents without control of their children. And a lot of the institutions for social control, especially in the beginning of the 20th century in Los Angeles and in the Southwest, were not able and were unwilling, quite honestly, if we're looking at the schools and police, to address some of these problems. So many of these youths were left to their own devices and almost naturally joined gangs, something of an active revolt right there. So there was multiple marginality for Mexican-American peoples, which perhaps explains their movement into gangs. And in a little while, we'll take a look at somehow the artistic development that came out of this sequestered segregation that happened in many of the cities in the Southwest here. But let's look at Dionysius. This is a great character in the Greek storylines. Dionysius was something of an odd god because he represented wine, There is an image of Dionysius holding a cup. And he would take his maenads, these women who would go up into the vines, into the fields, and take of the grape and become totally intoxicated. In fact, the word enthusiasmos means to be filled with the god. The idea being that you are in some form of intoxication. Okay, it's literal alcoholic intoxication, but at the same time, you're being led by this god who stands for not just wine, but for emotion, and he happens to be the god of the drama, primarily because he could change his shape into a woman or a man or a goat. Anything. His transformational abilities were amazing. And in some of the plays, we see him actually change his shape to be able to eavesdrop on someone. So that ability to change is what actors always talk about, that ability to play a lot of different kinds of roles. So it's very appropriate that Dionysius should be the patron of actors, if you will. And the play itself deals with the original play, the Electra play, deals with the famous House of Atreus, the curse of the House of Atreus. And this is how ancestral crimes were handed down, one brother getting some revenge on another brother. It all begins going back to Tantalus, who served his brothers, Pelops, his own sons in, now this is a myth, okay, it's not realistic, served his own sons to him, right? Killed his sons and actually fed them to him. And that caused a curse to happen so that by the time it comes down to Atreus, Atreus was doomed by this curse. And later the brothers fight and Atreus serves Thyestes, his sons, the same act. But one of the sons gets away, Aegisthus, and Aegisthus is going to have an affair with Clytemnestra. Clytemnestra is the wife of Agamemnon, the great leader of the Greeks against Troy, so that when Agamemnon returns, his wife and Aegisthus kill him. And that's what begins at least Aeschylus' famous play, The Oresteia, where the mother is killed by the son and daughter, Orestes and Electra. And then the whole question of the play is whether the revenge should stop there or does Orestes deserve to die as well. And the play actually finishes with a judge, Athena, comes down and says, we have to judge this case by 12 citizens chosen from other citizens, and they decide what happens. Well, it turns out that the court is evenly divided, and Athena rules in favor of Orestes, that Orestes should live rather than die. And that is the first case we have of showing the judicial system, at least on stage. So all of those origins of democracy have a lot to do with what was being shown in the theaters at the time. But basically, we're looking at the background of the Trojan War here and the return of the leaders back home. To some extent, Dionysius, though, represents something of that older world style, whereas in terms of the Mexican-American culture, the Pachuco has become something of the same mythic image. In fact, Luis Valdez, who is known to be the father of Chicano theater, starting by writing plays in 1965 for the grape strike that Cesar Chavez asked him to join, Luis Valdez created this concept in his play, The Zoot Suit, of this Pachuco character. Now, the Pachuco is a reference to basically tough Mexican-American gangsters who wear these loose clothes, wear wife beaters, flannel shirts, heavy makeup for the cholas in the culture, very penciled eyebrows. There's a whole very specific look there. But in Valdez's mind and Alfaro as well, the Pachuco was an attempt to react against some of the oppression that Mexican-American peoples were feeling, especially in the World War II years when servicemen from San Diego were driving into Mexican-American neighborhoods and beating up these guys who were dressed with the big lapels because they didn't like that kind of flamboyance that they were showing. Really, it was an expression of race pride, if you will. So the Zoot Suit Riots were a very unique time in the Southwest area here. And that flamboyance, as you see in that great image, provoked many to react against it as well. So it was a time of revolt. And just a little bit in terms of the kind of thinking, we mentioned that the humanities also involves philosophers as well, but it's interesting that Friedrich Nietzsche, in The Birth of Tragedy, used these two famous gods, Dionysius and Apollo, as showing that we all, inside ourselves, are carrying out a sense of revolt. That revolt is almost psychologically driven by who we are as human beings. Basically, Nietzsche's concept was that we're all rebelling in ourselves because we all have the Apollo side, which says order, restraint, everything in moderation. That's actually on Apollo's temple in Greece. Nothing in excess. In other words, live a life that is in the middle. Don't take too many risks. And Apollo represents order. Dionysius, on the other side, represents disorder and letting yourself go wild. Obviously, there are two extremes there, and Nietzsche said that only the Superman is capable of having the right balance between your Apollonian order-driven side and your Dionysian side that once, well, Freud would later talk about the id, that kind of drive, that sexual drive that everyone has within them, and the superego, that part of us that's saying, no, you can't do that. So this kind of struggle inside each person was envisioned by the great thinkers of our time as well. And as a result, Freud, as well as Carl Jung, went on and talked about the Oedipus complex. It's wonderful that Freud chose a famous Greek tragedy, a mythological story, it was a myth before it was a play, of a man who accidentally kills his own father, and as a result, because the father happened to be the king of Thebes, he gets to become the new king of Thebes, and he marries his own mother, unknowingly. Right? But Freud developed this whole concept that there is a natural antagonism towards the parent of your own sex, so that a boy is feeling competition against his father because he wants to, again, sleep with his mother. So the Oedipus complex. Jung was the one who really established the Electra complex, that female children regard their mothers as a competitor for the exclusive love of their fathers. And that is truly at the heart of our play today, Electricidad. So you can see that Alfaro was fascinated by not just the mythological story there, but there's some psychological aspects to what, at least in American culture, has come to be known as daddy issues. Part of urban slang has contributed this idea that turbulence or abuse or negligence in the relationship that you have with your father, male or female, can result in very troubled and insecure relationships with all men in adulthood, and that's regardless of whether you're homosexual or heterosexual by choice. So very interesting fascination with the underpinnings here psychologically. And in terms of gang life, there is the mindset, if you will, of la vida loca, the idea that you help to act out personal aggressions and rage and release a lot of the tension that has been placed by society on you because of the economic, even the geographical oppression. I mean, obviously, the barrio is kept separate. Many of the cities in the Southwest have their own section there. And now it becomes an aspect of protecting the barrio. And there's a question of honor that is natural for this. So younger members of gangs are expected to learn how to do local acts that prove that they belong to this subculture. So interesting dynamics that are at the center of this play, and they're revealed in very interesting ways throughout. And in terms of the differences between the arts, that's another thing as an upper division humanities, it's worth taking a look at. You know, Greek sculpture was the first time that we had freestanding nudes. Prior to that, if you looked at Egyptian sculptures, you would look at figures that were kind of locked into the background. They were never free of the material. Whereas in terms of, if you look at the Charioteer of Delphi, which was actually put back together again after the ruins of the Persian War, but the beautiful grace and poise that is in these figures is come to be known as very lifelike, very idealized. There's an image, there's the image of the Charioteer of Delphi, but these are the first time that we have freestanding nudes. There's a Zeus image that may be even a more unique image here. It may be Zeus, it may be Poseidon, it's always been debated, but the unique thing about this great bronze is if you would drop the arms down, if you could drop the arms down, they would come like to the knees. Now, you can't touch your knees standing up. They are anatomically incorrect, and the Greeks did this quite a lot. They did it in their temples as well, in their architecture. They would amend certain measurements to make it look more powerful. Obviously, throwing the javelin here, the idea of these arms being so extended was the idealized image. A lot of what Greek arts and theater is about is the idealization, making it more driven by goals rather than driven by a desire to replicate the exact way that the human body looks. The Romans did that. It's kind of interesting that the Romans did not have that idealization. They wanted a sculpture to look exactly like the man, exactly what he was looking like at that time. If he had warts on his face, they'd be in the sculpture. We're not going to idealize him in any way. So it's interesting that the Greek aesthetic featured a kind of more of a magical quality rather than an attempt to duplicate reality. For instance, the famous discus thrower, that famous sculpture of the man throwing the disc, this is actually a Roman copy. And in many cases, we don't have the original Greek sculptures. Thanks to the Romans and their desire to duplicate things, they gave us the Greek originals. But no human body can do that. If you try to put someone's body into that position, you'd crack his back. So the Greeks, again, they wanted to create a sense of power, create a sense of movement. And that's a very unique part of what I think true art does. It doesn't try to just duplicate reality. It wants to create some vision that kind of takes you in a direction. So, famous image there of the discus thrower. Now, on the Cholo side, it's amazing how this subculture has developed so many almost ritualized forms in terms of the signs that are used, maybe hand signals, different symbols that you'll see in tattoos, in graffiti. There's a car culture that goes along with Cholo life, different markings. There's obviously, we talked about the dress. There's something in the walk, right? There's even a connection in terms of the language. A pachuco speaks calo. Calo is using words like esse, mano, and it becomes a kind of badge that you wear that helps you to fit in. It's natural to all groups do that. They have their own kind of codes, and it's fascinating how extensive it is for the Cholo culture, and that's another reason why Alfaro found this to be a lucrative source, because you're really presenting not so much just a duplication of East LA life, but you're looking at the grand symbolism that goes into tattoos and images on walls in terms of graffiti, or in fact, Chicano murals actually dates back to Aztec times. We'll look at it more extensively when we deal with Sherry Moraga's play, Heroes and Saints, which is very much about social protest. That's the connection that we make with Sherry Moraga's play. But just a quick look. I mean, we have so many, even in L.A., fabulous images that were painted on walls that have something of a political protest to it. I think there's one in there that shows you the removal of people from Chavez Ravine back in the 50s in order to build the Dodger Stadium. And that was meant, these murals were meant as political statements. They were not for a museum, they were for the center of town. So it's interesting that protest has, oh, there's that famous mural that shows the removal of people from Chavez Ravine, which was a Chicano area, Latino area, but they wanted to build Dodger Stadium. So it was a very controversial time. The removal of those families. Well, let's talk a little bit about the play. And there you see our phone number there, so feel free to call in as we start looking at a little more depth in terms of the play. Electricidad is visually very interesting. I mean, whether it was its original production in Tucson, Arizona, or later at the Goodman in Chicago, the production I saw here at the Mark Taper was wonderfully done and with great, great actors. If you want to just look at an image of Electricidad herself, I mean, this fascinating look at a woman who stays on stage the entire play over the dead body of her father. What an that's not in the original play at all. That's one of the things that's unique about what Luis Alfaro did, was take it to a whole different realm by being able to bring us, in the original play, you have Electra, who is mourning the loss of her father, but she's basically at a grave site, you know, and it's a beautiful grave, but she is... excuse me, I'm trying to bring an example up of the actual play. She is not, you're not seeing the body of Agamemnon there. It's his gravesite, and she's pouring oils and saying prayers over it. But Alfaro does a very interesting thing here. When you walk in to the theater, this is at least the way it was done for the Mark Taper Forum, they observe this basic pattern there. Is sitting in the yard, and he describes the yard quite beautifully. One of the things in reading your plays, make sure you look at the opening stage directions, because the playwrights give you such great information. We see a yard in front of a casa at the end of a block. Not one of the kept-up ones, pero una yarda with dirt, shrubs, stones, and some stuff that didn't fit in the house. En la yarda is an altar made of stones. Nestled between the stones are objects that live on altars, votive candles, burning incense, fragrant flowers, a Bart Simpson piggy bank from the border, old and faded pictures. And at the center of the altar lies the decomposing body of Agamemnon, El Ogi Atridas, the father, el former rey de la neighborhood. Eyes plucked, tongue missing, he is wrapped in a shroud. Sitting in the yard, draped over El Ogi, is Electricidad, his youngest hija. She has been sitting in the yard for 5 days, waiting. Waiting for what? Quien sabe. So when you walk into the theater, you're seeing a very unusual thing. The Electra version, the original version, is not as interesting when you're just looking at a woman sitting there grieving over the actual gravesite of the father. And... in this version, as you can see in this wonderful image from the Taper production, here you've got the woman herself, but the dead body is there. So you're saying to yourself, why do they have the body? Why aren't they going to bury that body? And like the Vecinas, you would be asking a good question. What is she doing? Why is she not letting us bury this poor man, right? So it's very interesting that we all of a sudden know that there's a protest being staged here. This woman is not letting anybody touch the dead body of her father for some reason that she wants to speak out the injustice. So the action of the play is beautifully put right into the visuals that Alfaro has done. I just want to draw your attention to something. You saw me reading from what is the production script. When you do a production of a play, the director creates a prompt script, is actually what it's called. I don't know, Angie, if you can get a look at this, just so that you're kind of aware. I don't think I've shown one in this class yet, but this is actually an image from the production that was done at the Goodman Theater that I have just on the front of it. I just thought it was kind of an interesting idea. They took away the house itself. The house in their production is just simply poles that indicate the structure of a house. And here's the body of Agamemnon connected to a chain and his daughter Electricidad. But I just have this on the front cover. But this is basically a cover of the auditions. But then you have the actual script. And in a director's script, you need to put across from the actual lines of the play, you would put the blocking. You would want to have indications of who does what. I know you can't read this, but this is what we call the blocking page. And it's written so that it tells what is happening at this point in the script. So throughout the whole play, you have the stage movement documented with it's kind of like a code in stage manager's notation. So you have the lines on this side of the play, but over here you'll have, for instance, the character's name, Nino crosses right, Orestes stands. So you actually have images, too, to show where people are standing at certain times. And the rest of the script are handouts that you would have, your research into the play, anything that have to do with scheduling, rehearsals, audition information. So it's your handbook for how to do the production, basically. But I'll use it to read some scenes. But yeah, that's a unique part of this play, is that it begins with this image of Electricidad on stage. And the other characters, like Iphigenia, now there's the original character, Iphigenia, is from the Electra play, and it is the sister to Electra. But this Iphigenia is totally different. Alfaro really did a major jump to take a Chola, who had been very active in her gang life, to now want to become, to go and live with nuns in Fresno. And this is a great image. I think if you guys can get close up on this, you'll see that I forget the name of the actress who played Iphigenia, but she was a tough commodity. And you could tell she had a world of of a lot of street fights in her past. But there she was, even though she had the tats on her neck and everything, in a schoolgirl's outfit, looking like, good Catholic school girl living with the nuns there in Fresno. So wonderful contrasting character. The opposition that Alfaro wrote for this character was very, very unique. and our production here at Dominguez Hills was I think, very fascinating, too. I had such terrific people for it, like Griselda Marquez, who played the role of Electricidad, and she was just wonderful. In fact, I'm going to give you a little look at what Griselda did. There you see her with the body of El Olgi. I remember in rehearsal, it's fascinating to try to do this, but I wanted Griselda to make the audience believe that when they saw her touching the body of the father, that the father was alive. I wanted her to make the father still alive, which is kind of what Electricidad's problem is in the play. She's treating this guy as if he's living on, but and not accepting his death, protesting so arrogantly about it, that she really believes he's still with her. So I want to give you a little look at that. But first, Let's look at the opening scene. Why does Alfaro begin the play this way? He has what he calls the vecinas. So at the beginning of it, you hear an east los rooster crows, daybreak, the sound of the work begins, the sweep, sweep, sweep of brooms. Electricidad sleeps at her altar with the father's body, and the faint sound of chisme approaches as we see a trio of vecinas sweep down the street, a Griego chorus in house dresses and aprons. So he's saying a Greek chorus, but this time we've transferred them to house dresses and aprons. These mujeres, their chisme is accompanied by the rhythmic sweeping of brooms. So we'll pick up a little section of... this is a clip from our production that was done about 2 or 3 years ago. But just give you a little feeling of the vecinas. And let's really ask that question that was so wonderfully phrased by Peter Claussen about what is the dramatic function of the vecinas. So as you're watching this, you may want to think about that. So this is from our production of Electricidad.
She won't talk to us.
She's in silence.
Like your papa.
Agamemnon.
El Agi.
Another weird name.
And who told you all of this?
Same person who told you. Don't look at me.
Oh, you know that she's not sad.
Gossiping.
Not like us.
And the sister?
What happened to the sister?
Ifihania.
That Ifi.
Man off.
No.
How can a child ever break off?
It's like a coyote in the city.
Spiritual death for sure.
And she used to be the meanest of them all.
Didn't like the boys too much.
Cut them up to no razón.
Danced with girls?
You mean she was?
Yes. A Catholic schoolgirl.
A poco.
Oh, no me digas.
And he gets such humor out of it. You know, Greek choruses were never funny. But he is, in a way, having a bit of a laugh by having these chisme ladies. Notice the way they talk, though. We'll have to talk further about Peter's question about why such short little snippets. Why don't they speak in any long sentences? In fact, if you look on the page, the way it's written, you have three columns, and hardly anyone says anything more than border the river, in the shadow of the skyscrapers. Everybody has this short little phrase to say. And I'll get to that because it actually has origins in the famous Greek plays. But I see we have someone on our phone line, so I'm always eager to talk to someone. So this is Yamuna. Thank you, Yamuna. Thanks for calling.
Hi, Professor. How are you?
I'm great, and thank you very much for watching the show and responding to us in person here, on the phone at least.
Oh, sure. I have actually, like, so many questions about this play, but I really enjoyed reading it, and I actually found some clips of the DHTV production on YouTube of Orestes when he was in Vegas with Nino. Mm-hmm. So it was interesting to watch that.
Yeah, because the whole set has to be the house, but how do you do the Vegas scene? So we just had to do a little corner scene.
Right.
We'll show you examples of that.
Yeah, but the question that I had was, I got the impression that Orestes seemed more, it was almost like he wasn't that close with his family. Like, he was sent to Vegas, and he was trying to toughen up, but it wasn't like he really wanted to go back to his, his home. It was almost like he was happy away from there. Mm-hmm. And then I felt that, I don't know if it was that he was sensitive, but I also felt that he was kind of weak, like he didn't want to face his responsibility.
That's a good point. And that's the thing about theater too, Yamuna. You could play it that he's weak, or you could play it that he's sensitive and didn't want to become a gangster, didn't feel it was right, and maybe it was carrying some revolt in his own sensitivity to that. But I see that you posted here, I saw Orestes as weak, not sensitive, and this was further confirmed by Electricidad's ability to convince him to kill his mother. That is a good example of his weakness, that he was not able to stand up to her. She really pushed him to it. So
that's what I got out of the play with his character, is that she was able to push him, even though he was in the room with his mother, like it felt like he was melting down. She was talking to him in the last scenes, and then outside the window, Electricidad yells, "Do it," or something to that effect, and it's just like he does it and goes crazy. I felt that he will regret that decision to be forced into that.
He seems to just be mad at the end as a result of it, mad, insane mad. And it's a great point you're also making. I was going to ask the question later on. When the killing happens at the end of the play, we're giving away the ending, but why does Orestes not say anything? The mother has a monologue, basically. I have a page number here, page 50, but Clemencia just keeps talking, and Orestes doesn't open his mouth. And I was going to ask why can't he respond in any way? And I think you're right. I think he's doing it in some kind of a weak way, just following what his sister is doing, pushing him to it. So
it's almost like he's not taking responsibility for his actions. He's just doing it based on someone else telling him what to do.
And that brings up that whole issue of whether, why does Electricidad need a man to carry out this act? Why does she need Orestes to do it? Why can't she just do it herself? To some extent, she does do it herself, because she really pushes Orestes to do the act, but she's the motivation behind it, that's for sure. Well, that's great, Yamuna. You have lots of good insights, and thank you so much for sharing them with us, and I hope to hear you call us again sometime. Thanks, Yamuna. Yeah, it is that, I hate to say this, to some extent it may sound a little manipulative, but a good playwright, Mr. Shakespeare as well, wants audiences to think. If you write a play and it just is so definite that it has to be one way, in English classes they call it dramatic ambiguity, the idea that you're not exactly sure whether this is a weak character or strong character. That's a good way to write a play, because then it makes the audience continually think, and I don't know if he's doing this because he's not capable of doing it, or is it because he's sensitive enough that he's trying not to hurt someone. So to some extent, a playwright likes to have a balance that can seem sometimes confusing, but the play would be over in the first act if the playwright was so definite that they didn't use ambivalence to their advantage. So a play is where you try to get the audience to participate with their imagination. Shakespeare has many long speeches about that. But really, thank you, Yamuna, for a lot of your comments there. I want to, before we take a break, just give you an example of why perhaps the Vecinas speak in such short, little clipped ways. Well, in the famous Greek plays, and Shakespeare did this as well, many playwrights do this, it has a terrible name, stichomythia, which is the Greek name for it, but it is something that is quite natural. When people speak in quick, short phrases, and between like two people, in this case three, as we have the Vecinas, it puts everyone in the audience kind of on edge. It almost makes you listen more intently, because all of a sudden you're at a ping pong match and the words are flying very quickly. It's a great way to draw attention of the audience. It also creates tension. It creates a sense of there being some kind of sparking going on between people. So it's a great way to show conflict, and in many tragic plays it can be done to bring that out. I'm going to read a little section from just the original play of Electra by Sophocles. Now, this was translated by an English playwright, and you'll understand that when you hear the kind of English sensibility. But notice just how quick it goes back and forth. This is the moment when Electra is, this new character appears to her, and it turns out that she doesn't know that it's her own brother, all right? Orestes returns, but is in disguise. And at the end of the scene, I'm not going to get to it, I don't think, he reveals that he's her brother, and there's this great discovery, you know, reconciliation. But listen to how the dialogue just goes. Electra says, "What hath troubled thee? Why didst thou say that?" Orestes says, "Is this the form of the illustrious Electra that I behold?" Electra says, "It is, and very grievous in her plight." Orestes says, "Alas, then, for this miserable fortune." Electra, "Surely, sir, thy lament is not for me?" Orestes, "O form cruelly, godlessly misused." Electra says, "Those are ill-omened words, sir, fit no one better than me." Orestes, "Alas for thy life, unwedded and all unblessed." Electra, "Why this steadfast gaze, stranger, and these laments?" Orestes, "How ignorant was I then of mine own sorrows." This goes on for a number of pages, okay? Every character says only like one sentence. It's what they called stichomythia, and it created a sense of tension. In fact, Alfaro's phrases for the Vicenas are even shorter. So it is a way of not only giving us characters who are telling us about the world of the play, about the things that they're hearing, and introduce us to the characters. They talk about the mother. They talk about Electricidad. What is she doing out there with the body? They talk about the sister who's in Fresno. So it's introduction. It's exposition, as we call in a play. But also it creates a kind of active style. If you can imagine 12 people standing on stage and speaking the kind of language I just read, it's hardly engaging. But in Alfaro's version, I hate to use the word electric, but to some extent it's most appropriate for this play. So that's what stichomythia is. And I see we're almost at the halfway point, so I'm going to take a little break here. But when we come back, I want to introduce you to Electricidad and look at some of the monologues that she does in the opening. And I also want to talk again about the use of Spanglish in the play and how this play fits in the Theater of Revolt. So I hope you'll join us after our break for Electricidad on Theater of Revolt.
You are watching DHTV, the television program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
We have award-winning artist Mary Higuchi, who will unveil her original painting created in celebration of our 50th anniversary of CSU Dominguez Hills. Mary, please join us. The theme of the 50th anniversary is honoring our history, forging our future. And as the university looks to its next 50 years, I hope my painting, E Pluribus Unum, will continue to describe the rich multicultural diversity that is at the heart and core of California State University, Dominguez Hills. Thank you.
My name is Travis Shannon, and I decided to come to Cal State Dominguez Hills to the Digital Media Arts program because of the small class sizes, personal one-on-one attention I receive from instructors, as well as the freedom that I have to create the projects that I want to.
Four.
Yeah.
I'm Tiffany from Cal State Dominguez Hills Athletics, and this is the Toros Coaches Corner. Today we have with us the women's cross country coach, Deanne Schlobom. Hi, coach.
Hi. Welcome.
We had one of the more competitive teams we've had last season. Tell us what the team learned from that experience and what we can look forward to this year.
Well, the team learned a lot. They learned to stay focused, they learned to attend practice and be rigorous about their training, and they learned to develop a vision for what they want to accomplish and not to deviate from the course of their vision.
We return almost all of our runners to this year's squad. Is this the year we challenge the elite teams in the conference?
We are in a developmental stage, and the runners we have that we're adding to our program are phenomenal. We have Aston Price out of Riverside College, and we have Bridget Fernandez coming, and I think they'll be a great addition, plus some extras. And I think the team is growing and developing, and you're going to see something exciting from the cross-country team this year.
And which newcomers can we expect to make an immediate impact?
I think you'll see some exciting results from Bridget Fernandez, like I said, and Aston Price, and our returners, Erica Beal. And who knows who else is going to surprise us this year. We'll see what kind of good summer training they've done.
And what do you, as a head coach, look forward to the most from this year's team?
I look forward to each one of the athletes performing to their best and improving their times and building on the program we started last year.
Well, Coach, I thank you for joining us in this edition of the Toros Coaches Corner. And until we see you in the stands, remember to make every day your masterpiece. Go Toros.
Go Toros.
Enrich your life. Increase your earning potential. Cal State Dominguez Hills offers a master's degree in the humanities. With a focus on the cities of the world, this master's degree can be earned in as little as 5 semesters. Evening classes are available for your convenience. Why wait? Call 310-243-3636. That's 310-243-3636.
I basically took the distance learning course because I'm trying to get my California credential. I'm an out-of-state teacher. It's very convenient. I took last semester the health course from Joanna Chase, and I found that to be to my liking. I could study, relax, do it casually in the confines of my home.
I took one of the distance learning classes basically for convenience. It was nice to be at home in the mornings and watch it at home. Or, you know, if it didn't work out that way, I could tape it and kind of watch it at my own leisure.
Well, I took the distance learning course because it's I'm able to watch the videos anytime I want at my convenience, and it's easy to do that. I can watch it at home or either at the media center, and I would recommend this to a friend.
Teatro Dominguez is a multicultural theater company here at Cal State Dominguez Hills. And the program is designed to do play readings, workshops, and folktale tours to local elementary schools. We do that every year. The idea is that we are not doing theater so much as entertainment. Doing theater to help make our lives better. It is community service first and theater second. So, for instance, Teatro would do a play reading of a play about assimilating into American culture if you're an Asian immigrant. And that may be performed in a middle school or here on campus. Had a number of teachers ask Teatro Dominguez to come into their classrooms to
to read scenes. We have workshops where we would bring a group like Culture Clash in or Cornerstone Theater Company to help our students learn about community-based theater creation. And the touring show is always interesting. Every year we take a folktale or we create a folktale of our own, which is animals talking in masks, and we tour it to local 7th grade classrooms. So what Teatro does is really educational theater. It is theater that focuses on social issues, and it has more of a direct purpose for society.
This is my university.
Hey, Mark, nice paper.
On this job, safety is our first concern. There's a lot that can go wrong. But fortunately, we have Cal State Dominguez Hills, the only authorized OSHA training center in the Los Angeles area. If you're in need of OSHA certification, or if safety is one of your concerns, call 888-4LA-OSHA and learn how to be safe. Remember, safety comes first.
Watching DHTV, the broadcast program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Hi everyone, I'm Bill DeLuca. Welcome back to Theater of Revolt. We've been talking about a wonderful play, Electricidad, by Luis Alfaro. And I'm about to show you a little clip of the opening of our play. But it's interesting, we've been talking about stichomythia, what happens when you have characters speak very short lines back and forth to each other quickly. And it creates a sense of tension. It creates almost a sense of humor as well in our vecinas, the neighborhood ladies of the play. And that helps to set a lot of the exposition of just where we are. But it also, in Alfaro's version, it creates a sense of connectedness between the women. When characters talk that quickly between each other and they don't use, like I do, in between sentences, it moves so smoothly and quickly that you get a feeling that these vecinas represent more than just three women from the neighborhood. They are the neighborhood. So the world of the play is very much represented in the vecinas, and that means that their function is very significant. At the end of the play, notice how the vecinas always appear separate from everybody else in the play. But at the end of the play, they're going to actually come in to clean up Electricidad when she decides to give her father over. This is after the mother has torched the body. But the dramatic function of the vecinas is they contribute a sense that they want some order back in this neighborhood. They don't want this disturbance. So Alfaro has done a wonderful job in taking what had been people standing off from the side making comments in the Greek tragedies and making them have a stronger dramatic function. So it's really a unique aspect. And we've had a lot of comments from students. Yamuna was asking, when we look at a play, at how a play fits into Theater of Revolt, do we look at the social setting of when the play is actually written or the time and setting of the play? I'd say the time and setting of the play, Yamuna. In other words, what Alfaro was focusing on right here is life in East L.A. But there is some interesting parallels that go back to show perhaps that revenge is a problem that is always with us. It seems that is many different cultures have tried to solve the bloodletting, but it's one of the tragic implications for many, many cultures, is how to handle the problem of revenge. That's why the Greek myths were so dominated by it. It's why we hear about it so often in our culture as well. So, very good question. In fact, Yamuna has also asked, if Electricidad was not written by a Latino, I'll have to look that up a little bit later, but that was a good question, too. I'll bring that up a little bit later. So let's get a look at her opening monologues. And I ask you the question, why so many different monologues? In the play, at least if I were to do page numbers, Electricidad first talks to us on page 10, then she comes back on page 15, then she comes back again on page 17, and interspersed in between there are scenes by the Vecinas, a scene of her brother Orestes, who is in Vegas hiding with Nino, who is preparing him to come back and take over control from his father. And then we have a scene with the grandmother, Abuela, bringing in her other sister, Ifigenia, to basically talk to Electricidad. Why intersperse all these monologues in between these scenes? Well, let's take a little look at an example of Electricidad. This is the first time we actually see her talk, although we've seen her on stage protecting the body. Realize when a scene changes in this play, Electricidad does not get up and go off stage. She's there on stage the entire time, which tells us her purpose in protecting that body. Very, very important. All right, so here's a little clip of Electricidad at the opening of the play, Electricidad.
Papa, why do I keep looking up to see heaven? I only get as far as the sky. Why is it the only light that shines on me? The happy face of the helicopter. I wonder if you could be born again and really come back. I am waiting for a cloud to pass by, spit in my mouth. But the Santa Anas keep pushing them away. To Vegas, I guess. When I finally do get God to spit down on me, I'm going to say that it is a blessing. And I'm going to use my spit to get back my soul. She's been out there.
5 days? Uchi.
Chule. She's a stubborn chola.
Always been. She sits there forever looking up at the sky like she's waiting for a UFO or something. And then she has these conversations with herself out loud.
Has she talked to Mama?
Don't talk to me about to Mama. She got the sanitation department to come scoop her Electricidad up. But la loca Electricidad, she attacked the poor cabacho trash man. Pinned him like a pit bull. Threatened to drive by him. He said, we're running a pobre.
What's that next to her?
The body, mujer. El cuerpo of my dad. My son.
My God.
La loca has his body on display in the front yard. Like some rose parade flow.
Somebody's going to steal it.
No, chance. When she brought the body here, she stayed with it. She hasn't left, not even for a momento. She even pee-pees in the yarda. She's acting like she's at Yosemite or something. I tell you, she's a cacahuate.
How does she survive?
Like all cholas do. I'm a grandmother. I leave her comida every day. You know, tortillas and stuff. Some top ramen. Hey, I even bake pinche cupcakes for the loca. and she does me a favor? You know, Ravita, you watch your grandmother's back and your granny watches yours, hmm?
I got your back, abuela. It's so hard. Ni lo puedes imaginar, a poor vieja like me in my twilight. I'm back to feeding another mouth, hmm? A senior citizen como yo, making a Los Rice Krispies con a food coloring y todo. And my pobre widow's pension. Don't worry, vieja. I'll make sure mama gives you some dinero.
Ay, gracias. And now, even worse. La loca stopped talking to las vecinas. She's got them all up with us. They think that she's going to attack them. Hmm? When she sleeps, they leave flowers and incense for her. Pues more for the smell of the body. Hmm? They hired me to hablar with her.
You charge them?
Well, I'm like a translation servicio.
My poor sister.
Where did you become so nice, Harchola?
When I realized that someone died on a cross for me.
Oh, really? Who was that?
Don't be disrespectful, old lady.
Why you come back here, Harchola? You've been gone so long, we thought you gave up the vida.
Came back to make amends. I'm kind of like on a pilgrimage. To save the familia.
Good luck, Chola. You got an hermano and a papa both dead. You don't got that many people to pilgrim with.
What does she do all day?
She sleeps. She's on the coyote cycle. At night, she talks to herself or to him like a loca, laughing and crying, reliving herself and her vida. Como on a rerun. She's planning something. I know it.
And how do you know?
I stay up and watch her.
Oye, mujer, you should let her grieve in solitude.
But I'm a retiree. This is what we do. Besides, what kind of loca grieves in her own front yard for everyone to see, hmm?
She just doesn't want to forget. How did she get the body?
She stole it from Forest Lawn the night of the velorio.
How do you know?
Mujer, I drove the hearse.
Shit!
Abuela! She told me she'd kick my nalgas if I didn't. So I broke into the funeral car while she went into the little chapel of the Inocentes and took the body. Hmm? Like a fly, he slid off the stretcher into the hearse. And then she made me drive him a key. Now I don't even have a license. You know what? She's got like a rabies, I think. You need to hablar with her. She's your sister, tú sabes?
My hermana. We never acted like we were sisters.
But I'm warning you. Cuidado. She strikes when you least expect it.
She wouldn't come at me.
Oh, she thinks you were in on the viejo's murder.
Está loca.
Pues, that's what I said. Pero who listens to the viejas anymore?
Jesus does.
Why, don't you give me that hallelujah stuff, man. If there was a God, I wouldn't be making government cheese quesadillas.
Okay, scram, old lady. I want to hablar con mi sister.
Ay, you girls got no manners, man.
Well, we learned it from you, cabrona.
No. That comes from your mama, the outsider.
Hmm? Oh, now she's the outsider.
Well, look at her. She's not from here. Whittier Boulevard runs a long way, baby. Hmm? I told my hijo, don't take a girl with something, because soon they want everything. Take a girl with nothing, give her something, and it feels like a lot.
You are the Chola Most High.
Oh, I don't know nothing. But what I know about nothing is a lot. And I know I hate that puta. No Vegas buffet could satisfy a mujer that hungry for power. Hmm? And she doesn't even know how to dress.
Ay, no seas mala.
I tell you, the only Mexican I got any respect for these days is the Virgende Guadalupe.
Vete, vieja. Hey. Hey. God bless you.
Ay, gracias. Religiosa cabrona.
You should have seen it, Papa. They had you lying there, in that mortuary, on display, like some dummy in a store window. I couldn't have it, Papa. Laying there all night by yourself. Why did they do that? Why did they leave someone alone on their first night of dying? It isn't right.
You are not dead to me. You are the ray of this neighborhood. Everybody waits for you to give your orders. Nobody stopped me from bringing you here. They thought that I had gone crazy. They just don't know what I'm capable of when it comes to my love and loyalty to you, mi rey. You are the old ways, Papa. You are the history and the way we know how to live. I want to live the old Cholo ways. Simple and to the point. You mess with me, I mess with you back. You want a party? Party in your own backyard. You shoot, I shoot back. Simple. But can't live the old ways. She says I act like a man. Good. I'm not a girl. I'm a chola. Velocita, look good.
Well, sorry to go such an extended section there. But it presents a number of things. First of all, you see the structure of the play. There's the monologues interspersed with a big expositionary play where Abuela and Ifigenia come in. And we see that the grandmother is there to try to get Ifi to talk to the sister, to get her to give up this vigil by the body of the father. That is, in a way, the whole motivation behind the play. If he's going to try it, the mother's going to try it, the vecinas are going to try it, even abuela. In fact, the vecinas give the abuela $40 to try to get her to give up this protest as the body is getting older and older, 5 days that it's been on the front porch. So it is protest. It begins with an act of protest. And Ifi, Electricidad, in that very opening scene, shows you what's at the heart of this protest. It's not just anger. In fact, I remember working on the scene with Griselda a lot, that if it's just anger, then an audience can't really respect Electricidad. If it's pain, if it's heartfelt pain that she's going through with the loss of the father, then there's a sense that we can feel for what she's going through. Obviously, the act of putting the body on the front yard is so unrealistic that it's taking the play into a world where it's meant to be appreciated, not analyzed as an everyday play. This certainly wouldn't happen in everyday life. But that's what a play is. As soon as you put something up on a stage, it's in the realm of a more artistic view. We are holding up our lives and looking at it with some objectivity. Subjectivity, if you will, in terms of it being poetry, and I find this play quite poetic. It's written with a very educated sense of humor and sense of wit. Alfaro's humor is unique. I mean, what grandmother would ever say pinche cupcakes? I mean, there you've got this horrible word that you're not supposed to even use on the air with cupcakes. I mean, that's what a grandmother does, is make cupcakes. The opposition of those two words tells us a lot of what abuela is like. Abuela is not necessarily an exact grandmother from Latino culture. She's not a stereotype, that's for sure, because Alfaro has kind of positioned her to be such a unique blend of opposites. She's there to help, but at the same time, she's tough as nails. And there are many grandmothers that we have like that, so I contradict myself in that respect. But it's a dramatic character. It's meant to, like the other females in this play, be a little bit over the top. It is very dramatic, theatrically dramatic, what he's created here. So very unique style of playwriting that Alfaro has. And one of the things that's kind of unique about this play is there's 31 scenes in it. That's a lot of scenes in a play that's only, what, going to be 2 hours long, 60 pages in script. That means you've got an average of almost one scene every 2 minutes. My point is, it's very choppy, and most plays are not written that way. This is written more as a film script, where you're splicing in and out of scenes. It's meant to be an electric shock between scenes. So it's meant to move in the same way that electricity is meant to happen. So he's tapping a kind of theme, a kind of image, a central metaphor, if you will, and using it in the actual structure of the play. It's jumbled up. It's very much trying to show a kind of frazzled world. In fact, there's a wonderful comment here that Theodore Olson posed in the discussion boards, and I'd like to just read this. Theodore says, in a culture where family is so central, Latino, Hispanic, American culture, why does Alfaro show us such a disloyal and dysfunctional family dynamic? Great question, Theodore, because yes, this family is not your typical Latino family at all. It's very highly dysfunctional. So that's a great question that Theodore poses, and I'll just show you some of the comments that were responded to. Here's Stephen saying, hi, Theodore. I believe that Luis Alfaro wrote the family as so ultimately dysfunctional to show us the tragedy of the culture. The inability to trust one's family really shows us that Cholos are alone even in their family. They are all individuals with no real means of support. They cannot trust each other, even in such a family-centric culture. It just perpetuates from generation to generation. It's a vicious cycle. Great question. That's great, Stephen, because you're kind of saying that getting away from the family aesthetic is going to isolate you as an individual, that the movement into the gang world may seem like you're joining a group, but in a way you're isolating yourself from those values that we know that are so central to most Latino families. So that's a great response. And I want to show you another response, because the students can actually respond to responses. And Yamuna, who was here earlier, actually said to Stephen, your response really helped me to understand why this play is in Theater of Revolt. Maybe because I enjoyed reading this play, I was having trouble critically thinking and figuring out what the playwright was trying to say in the play. Yamuna, I have to point out to you and everyone that this is one of the problems. Sometimes when you get into a play, and obviously when you're in a film, you just want to follow it. You just want to go along with the story. And I'm delighted that Yamuna has said, you know, I was so engrossed in it that I wasn't able to stop and objectively think about it. Well, quite honestly, I'll tell you, when you direct a play or act in a play, you really have to read it two or three times, get over the fascination with following the story, and then take it apart. And that is tough. So a lot of what I'm asking you to do is read it once to enjoy it, but then ask yourself, how do they accomplish this, or how does something not get accomplished? So the analysis sometimes is not as interesting as following the actual play. I tend to agree with you. It's hard to then just kind of create some objectivity and try to figure out how it's all put together. But very good comment there by all of you. In fact, I see we have Yamuna back with another comment here saying, if Electricidad was not written by a Latino, would it have been seen as a negative, stereotypical representation of Cholo life? Interesting question. I think that's kind of perhaps. I mean, that's possible. You know, when I was working on this play with Griselda and many of the others, that was a topic that was brought up, you know, a lot. An actor doesn't like to stereotype characters, even though once a character is created for the stage, to some extent, you want them to be recognizable. So a father on stage tends to do things that are fatherly. You wouldn't do things that are the young romantic if you're trying to pull off the father. So it's debatable what we want to call stereotypical. For instance, as I was mentioning, it would be stereotypical if I made Electricidad just all anger. If she was just all angry, then she's, yeah, just a chola looking for revenge with nothing motivating her other than her anger. A lot of what we wanted to do with Griselda is to give a sense that she had lost something very, very strong, that she was going through a grieving process as well. It wasn't just as simple as giving that up. I think one of our students actually brought that up. I forget. I'll have to see if I can find it. But that a lot of what is motivating Electricidad is that we see her out front grieving over the loss of the father. So if there's that sense of depth of emotion, then it's not so stereotypical if you have someone who's really feeling it. So I guess I'm saying perhaps it depends on how you do it. You could make these characters all very stereotypical, but I think Alfaro does have enough depth in the writing that you can create them to be lifelike and engaging, but not just stereotypical. I know when I did Fences, which was a black play, I feel that I achieved the ability to not stereotype the characters in there, and it's not because my being white was going to just immediately create stereotypical characters, but what I did do to avoid being stereotypical, I focused on the conflicts in the play, the antagonism between the father and the son. I understood that connection, and that's how I directed the play. So, I don't know, stereotyping usually has to do with it being very general and not being in depth in terms of the choices that the actors are making. So I'm talking in terms of how it's done, and it's sometimes tough to judge a piece of theater by how it appears on the page, just because the characters are involved in a Latino gang. Does that mean it's a stereotype? I mean, Latino actors will tell you that they don't want to do those roles. Like black actors for many years didn't want to do roles where they were shown as slaves. So, I mean, it's an interesting social comment. Actors felt that Latinos should be shown as lawyers. They should be shown, you know, owning property and working in real estate. And many great playwrights, Octavio Solis, have done that. And there has been, you know, a lot more freedoms. So it depends on how you want to define that word stereotypical, I guess. So for instance, here's Maria saying, interesting, she starts this out saying, hate play. I don't know if that means she hates the play or it's a play about hate. Hate play. Portrayal of Hispanics as uneducated, uncultured, illiterate. Interesting, because I think you need a subject to make that first sentence. No, don't scroll too far. I can't read. I think you're trying to say, I hate this play, which would require a subject. Bet all characters are brown because all Hispanics are brown. Very retrograde view. Wrong intonation when speaking. The short dialogues are similar to trailers. They set up a premise, question, leave audience wondering the what and what ifs. It's interesting, Maria, you talk about it being uneducated. I find this play quite literate. I mean, it is poetically created. The phrases, actors will tell you that it's so much fun learning the lines of this play because it has a poetic sensibility. I don't know nothing, but what I know about nothing is a lot. That's a sentence that makes sense, and it is structured in a clear way according to English principles. It is not choppy and making us wonder what was just said. So I don't know. It's interesting that you would say it's an uneducated play. I find this to be quite a perceptive look at not just East LA culture, but our world as well. So that I think it's very limiting to see this play only about Latino people. Is it for only Latino people? I know that Alfaro was writing for a much wider audience than just people who live in East LA. And, you know, as many students have said, the use of Spanglish is a number of students who've talked about how this is very much reflective of the world that they come from, that this is, you know, sounds very much the way their mothers and fathers talk. So it's, you know, it's an interesting debate. Once we choose to go into a certain, like, neighborhood, whether that's being stereotypical or whether we should keep plays kind of poetic and above the world so that we're writing more, I don't know, like, when Garcia Lorca would write imagined worlds then we could avoid any kind of stereotypical quality. But I don't know. I don't find this illiterate at all. I think you have an interesting reaction to the play. It's interesting that the first word that you used there was hate. The common thread in these works is the revolt not against society, but against men, the men who dictated society. Well, Greek culture, too, was highly patriarchal, even though many of the playwrights wrote plays that were after the names of women, Hecuba, Andromache, Electra, Medea. Women did not have any rights, whether it be in terms of the assembly or any say-so in that society. It was highly patriarchal culture. So that's another reason, perhaps, why Alfaro was choosing to adapt from that culture to basically say that, there are some powerful women in Latino culture, and all the women in this play are strong, strong characters, very vivid on-stage characters, that's for sure. And the men, yes, Nino and Orestes is another interesting character because, as we were saying with Yamuna, is he really weak to the point that he can be so easily manipulated into even killing his mother? Or is Alfaro saying that perhaps it's the sensitivity that Orestes possesses that is really the hope for the future, to resist this immediate knee-jerk reaction to just follow the Cholo lifestyle? So it's meant to make us think about whether we can't solve this problem of revenge or gang life, what might be the fascination. Most people tend to just not want to think about it. Well, here's a play that's making us think about it. There's something healthy about that idea. Here's Jordan saying that art, especially theater, is meant to transcend that kind of offensive stuff. If actors are offended by stereotypes in art, then they are in the wrong business. Yes, that's true. It's not that actors would be offended, Jordan. It's that you don't want to offend an audience member. So you have the choice when you're staging a play whether you want the character to be kind of generalized or, as in most good theater, somehow special, somehow specific of that world rather than just generally kind of showing anger, let's say, if that's part of what the scene is about. Actors learn that the anger should come from the situation. And so in some way, it's the similar thing to what I think you're saying. If actors are offended by stereotypes in art, then they're in the wrong business. I don't know. I think they can help improve the business by avoiding the put down of people. I mean, we laughed at blacks for well over a century in the minstrel shows. And in fact, when we talk about Flying West next week, we'll talk a little bit about that and what an effort had to be put in to getting authentic portrayal of African Americans on stage. So to some extent, it's sad, but it would not have happened without the concerted effort of actors and directors, people who wanted to, like Langston Hughes, portray us authentically. And that's happened for women, it's happened for Hispanic Americans, it's happened for Asian Americans. It's interesting, you don't get the vote by just asking for it. You go onto the streets and you actually have to fight for it. It's the American way. So very interesting comments on this. But let's take a little further look at the play too and see if are we being stereotypical? For instance, in this scene, we're going to see a scene between the mother and the daughter here. This is the section where Electricidad, this is where we're going to have a curse word in here. So I hope you're not offended by our use of this. But to some extent, the way Clemencia uses her version of Pasadena, you get a little bit of the sense of humor that Alfaro is using it. But you know, one of the most central conflicts of the play is whether Electricidad is going to be able to turn her sister, Ifigenia, against the mother. Very much, all families do that. It doesn't take, there's always something political to some extent in whose standing behind who. But Iffy is a reborn again Christian. She has a former gang member, so to some extent she is not about to join Electricidad in this desire that she has to kill the mother, which is what the original Greek play involves, is Clytemnestra revenging herself upon her husband, which in the original, the husband actually sacrificed the other daughter to make the winds blow so that they could go to Troy. So there's a whole cycle of revenge that runs this this great Greek classic. But it's interesting to ask, what is Clemencia's objective in the play? And this scene is going to bring it out. And a number of the students on the discussion board have brought this out too. But how do you think Clemencia is intending this to sound on Electricidad when she talks about this hombre world, meaning this man's world that she has tried to survive in? So another look at revolt in the play, this time from Clemencia's scene, but this is Pasa Bleep Dina from Electricidad.
I'm looking at the world, my daughter. Don't forget that I was the one who convinced the repo man to give us another chance on the Monte Carlo. You let the pitbulls attack him. Yeah, well, he gave us another chance, didn't he? I made sure the mortgage never died. I made sure you kids always had your cholo wear. I even scared the vecinas into buying all that Avon so we wouldn't starve when your papa got lost in some city terrace dies. Oh, don't look at me that way. You think it's easy being a woman in this hombre world? Those hombres are ruthless conmigo! And they will be with you too. They want one thing from us, and they always take it. But when we want to cut, a place in their world, our fair share. Well, vas a ver. You're the queen of excuses, Clemencia. I can't wait to see what you'll say when the hands wrap around your neck. I'll be here waiting. You think you can sit there forever? You think he isn't going to leave you at some point? They always leave you, these men. And then what? Who will watch your back then? Everyone smells the oportunidad that an empty throne brings. Without backup, little niña, you're like a wounded coyote out there. Let me protect you. Desperate. You know how I met your sweet papa? On the boulevard. I was 13. He smelled good, like VO5. And I flirted. What's wrong with that, huh? I was an innocent. But he took my girlhood from me in the back of a car. And he brought me here. Mm-hmm. My father looked at me and called me a tramp. My mother hid in a back room to save herself a black eye. And he sold me to him. Because he thought I was dirty. This is what they do. Did I get to escort her? No, my stubborn daughter. I didn't get to choose, and neither will you. History just keeps repeating itself. Cholos don't move forward. They just keep going farther into the past. Oldies, oldies, oldies. And I want to change all of that. I want to take back every bruise your father gave me and turn it into a dollar. I want the memory of every one of his punches to be a kiss that could make me believe in myself. I am going to start a business in his name if you want. I can give you a cut. Then you could have a piece of him that's worth something. The piece that makes dinero. You and I are cut from the same cloth, Electricidad. Imagine us working together. Together? Ha! These hombres wouldn't know how to deal with the both of us. They wouldn't be able to ignore us. I'll tell you eso. Think about it. Then you could honor his nombre, if that's what you want to do. We could even make a statue and put it out here where his stinky body sits. Come on! Come back inside the casa! Not into that living coffin. A mother sacrifices. I never did. I admit that. Just like you, I like the running around too much. I was never good with the domestic. But then again, I never meant to be a mother. But now we have to start pensando about our futuro. You and I are survivors.
No tengo nada in common with you, monster.
You hate me? Porque me ves inside of you. We are more alike than you can ever imagine.
Lies.
No seas mensa. This could all be yours. Yes, even the house.
Why would I want this house?
You love this house, más que yo. You can't wait to live out the last of your days in the past, looking out this window at a world that would never have us. Not me. I'm gonna forget all this, sell this house and buy a condo in Pasa. I would have even given him to you.
Stop it!
Oh, I know you wanted him.
Cállate!
You did, didn't you? Hard chola, with no friends to call her own. Your sister always in jail, your little brother too soft for his own good. Little chola, whose only friend was her hard papa. He took the soft skin from you and made you a warrior. And you are stupid enough to thank him for it. But why wouldn't you? You were in love with him. I hate you. Getting a new sentimiento? I hate me too sometimes. Listen to me. I am offering you things. Attention. Partnership. Motherhood, even if that is lo que quieres. All of the things no one ever gave me, I am offering to you. But you must pay me for it. I'll pay for your casket. Pay me for being your mama. I never wanted it. They took being a girl from me and they gave me mother. I didn't ask for it. No, my daughter. I am not old enough to be old. It's all yours, Electricidad. Make a choice. There's nothing to stand in your way now. You could change the destiny of La Casa de Atrinas. Mira, Mensa, take something from me. It's your last breath. Que quiero. Okay. I am going to start a neighborhood association. And you are going to be the first item on the agenda, cabrona. Last chance, are you coming inside or not? I'll come to your funeral, old lady. I'm going to go back inside and use up my anytime minutes. Don't say that I didn't warn you.
So the mother has this whole approach, which is, you know, you and I are very much alike. We could run this operation. We could make it into an interesting business. And a lot of students have kind of wondered, is Clemencia, the mother, honest in her somewhat feminist approach, talking about this hombre world, having to live in this man's world where they won't give us the power? Is she truly devoted to a political agenda here that's going to empower women in gang life, in LA at least? Or is she a power-hungry person who's just angry for the treatment that she received from the husband and out for her own power? How much is it individually based? How much is she working on ideals? Well, I can tell you one thing. This Clemencia is so much more interesting than the Clytemnestra of the original play by Sophocles. her defenses were pretty weak in that play. This character at least shows you that there's a an intelligence working here, because the point she's making is actually quite sound. And you would think someone like Electricidad, a fiery woman herself, would understand it. But Electricidad is so devoted to the patriarchal system, this fascination with the father, such that she doesn't feel she could kill Electricidad. She needs someone to do it for her. It's a wonder that she doesn't trust herself and know that she has the power to do it. She obviously has held off the whole neighborhood in this vigilance over the body. So to some extent, Afaro is talking about how sad it is that women won't allow themselves to take positions of responsibility in the family. And here's an interesting dilemma where the daughter is actually going to kill the mother and prevent that from happening. But most of the students feel that Clemencia is pretty much power hungry. She's not as strong a feminist as perhaps she may be asking. That is part of perhaps her ruse. So finally, Ifigenia, the mother actually has a scene with the other daughter, Ifigenia, telling her, you know, you better get your sister to give up this crazy idea. And Ifigenia cannot do it. And in fact, the mother torches the body, which convinces Electricidad to kind of give up. But then, boom, here comes Orestes. And we kind of understand now why Orestes was kept so separate. Because now the ending of the play comes with Orestes being kind of pushed to the act, as we talked about with Yamuna earlier. It's an interesting question that is posed here by one of our students. This is Yamuna saying, why does the return of Orestes cause Electricidad to want revenge again and convince him to kill their mother? Is her revenge motivated by ties to her gang family or ties to her blood family? Very, very good question to pose there. And it's interesting, the answer that Maria Jimenez offers is, as I sit here and think of her desire to kill La Chola, Electricidad was not strong enough to carry on her plot. I believe that she was going through what we know is a natural grieving process, of course, with extenuating circumstances. That's great, Maria. That's a comment that shows that there is some depth to Electricidad, and she's not just angrily opposing the mother there. There's something hurt underneath it. Okay, well, I see we're running out of time for the show. Next week, we're going to look at Flying West, which is the one play that you have to buy. So hopefully you'll be able to find that. And that is a wonderful example of Theater of Revolt. So I look forward to seeing you next Sunday for Theater of Revolt's Flying West.